Going to a session of God's Word on this beautiful day, on this beautiful Sunday morning in the month of September. As September begins to round up and we go into a new month this week, actually. We're going to a new month this week. So, we're going to a session of God's Word this morning and we continue in our series of restoring the years the locusts have eaten. Amen. Restoring the years the locusts have eaten. And as you will remember, we have looked at locusts from a biblical perspective, from different angles. What locusts means in the Bible and how they are used. And by now, as we begin to tie this up today, there's some things we've learned so far. Amen. We've learned that locusts were created originally, physical locusts were created originally as food for man. Yeah, God said we can eat the locusts. And we know John the Baptist actually ate locusts. And then, so we learned that. We also learned that locusts are, because of man's sins, because of our sins and our iniquities, locusts have become instruments of judgment in the hands of God. Amen. And we saw in our first part, of this series, we saw that locusts was used against the Egyptians. The Lord unleashed locusts, drove them, and his wind brought them to Egypt, and he devastated the agricultural produce of the land of Egypt. So we saw in there that locusts were used to, as a judgment against Egypt, as one of the 10 plagues, one of the 10 plagues in Egypt, the infestation of the locusts. And Joel also, and a few other prophets, Jeremiah, Amos, all of them saw an invasion of locusts destroying agricultural produce in the land of Israel as God judged them. So God using locusts as instruments of judgment was not just against the sinners, but it was also against his own people who had turned their backs on him. Amen. And then last week, we looked at another dimension of the use of locusts in scriptures. And the Bible says, when you see a horde of nations or armies coming against the land, they are also described as locusts in the Bible. And look at two key examples. Remember Babylon, when Joel saw that vision, he says, a nation strong and mighty has come against my people. He wasn't just talking about the physical locusts, he was talking about the invasion by Babylon. You also remember that I talked about what the swarming locusts have eaten, the swarming locusts, the cutting locusts, the chewing locusts, and the consuming locusts. Talking about four different types of locusts there, and we said that represented four different empires that would afflict God's people. And that's the Babylonian Empire, the Indo-Persian Empire, the Persian Empire, and of course, the Roman Empire. And then we narrowed it down to the story of Gideon last week, when the Midianites and the Amalekites attacked them, and the Bible says their horses and their camels were so many, they were like the locusts, they were millions, and they always attacked the produce of the people of God. Always attacked the produce of the people of God. And we saw how with 300 men, God destroyed the mighty locusts, the mighty army which came against his people, because Gideon reared up an altar unto the Lord. And the Lord showed him that it's not by power, not by might, but by my spirit, says the Lord. Amen. Now today, we will look at the third type of locusts we'll find in the Bible. This is more relevant for our time, Now, if you notice, you can look at the list of these locusts as one personal and the other national. You can look at it as something affecting us as individuals and something affecting the nations of the earth. Locusts destroy agricultural produce, that destroys the produce of the nation. But also in people's lives, their harvest can be destroyed. The invasion by Babylon or the Midianites against the people of God is a national catastrophe, but also we can have instances where people will rise up against us, where enemies will rise up against us to try to destroy our bridges. But in all of these things, the Bible says we are more than conquerors, hallelujah, through Him who loved us, and we will continue to enjoy that victory in the name of Jesus. This morning, we are going to have a free of this message, and today, we are considering locusts as demons attacking the earth. Locusts as demons attacking the earth. And we're going to look at that in a variety of ways. Locusts as demons attacking the earth. And when we go into this message, you will begin to see that there is a lot going on around us because of God's judgment upon the earth. Amen. Talk with me your Bibles to Revelation chapter 9. Let's look at this type of locust described in the Bible. The third type of locust you'll find in the Bible. Revelation chapter 9, we'll read verse 1 to 11. Revelation chapter 9, verse 1 to 11. The title is Restoring the Years the Locust Have Eaten, verse 3. So, Revelation chapter 9, verse 1 to 11. Revelation 9, 1 to 11. It says, then the fifth angel sounded. The fifth angel sounded, and I saw a star falling from heaven to the earth. To him was given the key to the bottomless pit, verse 2. And he opened the bottomless pit, and smoke arose out of the pit like the smoke of a great furnace. So the sun and the air were darkened because of the smoke of the pit. Verse 3. Then out of the smoke, locusts came upon the earth. So you can see another set of locusts there, coming out of the abyss, coming out of the pits where they were. Locusts came upon the earth, and to them was given power, as the scorpions of the earth have power. Verse 4. They were commanded not to harm the grass of the earth, or any green thing, or any tree, but only those men who do not have the seal of God on their foreheads. Verse 5. They were not given authority to kill them, but to torment them for 5 months. All of these things are bearing upon a day, upon an age, and a time. Their torment was like the torment of a scorpion when he strikes a man. In those days, men will seek death and will not find it. They will desire to die, and death will feel free from them. Verse 7. The shape of the locusts was like horses prepared for battle. On their heads were crowns of something like gold, and their faces were like the faces of men. They had hair like women's hair, and their teeth were like lions' teeth. And they had breastplates, and their breastplates like breastplates of iron. And the sound of their wings was like the sound of chariots with many horses running into battle. Verse 7. They had tails like scorpions, and there were stings in their tail. Their power was to hurt men 5 months. And they had as king over them the angel of the bottomless pit, whose name in Hebrew is Abaddon, but in Greek he has the name Apollyon. Just start from there. Abaddon and Apollyon. Abaddon in Hebrew and Apollyon in Greek means the destroyer. Amen. Alright, so what does this teach us? Here we see another swarm of locusts. So John the Revelator has just been shown another vision where an angel blew a trumpet. There was a sound. Now, where do you normally blow a trumpet? You blow a trumpet when there is war. Yeah? In the Bible, you blow trumpets either during the feast at the tabernacle, or when a king is being installed, or when there is war. Now, this angel blew trumpets, and why did he blow the trumpet? He was sounding an alarm. He was sounding an alarm. He was saying, you guys, we need to do something. People of the earth, this is an alarm. This is something you need to pay attention to. War is coming. If you read the previous chapter towards the end, he says, watch the inhabitants of the earth because of the last evils that are still coming upon them. So the angel blew the trumpets as warning that a new wave of evil is coming to the earth. Now, you ask me, we discussed, we talked about the wave of physical locusts eating agricultural produce. We talked about the wave of pestilence. We talked about COVID. We talked about all kinds of things happening all around us. We talked about that. So what is this new wave coming? What is this wave that that the angel was talking? And as we will see today, the wave of trouble coming upon the earth is the wave of deception. The locusts that will be released, as we see, will bring about deception upon the earth. We are living in an age and a time that men are deceived and they are going to be deceived. Amen. That is the age, and the agents doing this will be many. They will be like locusts on the earth. Lots of them. Lots of them. Locusts upon the earth. And these locusts will attack the earth in a variety of ways. I'll give you a few examples. Number one, the deception will start from outside the church. People's hearts. Let me just show you from scripture because of time. I wish I had more time this morning, but because of time, let me take this step by step, as you will see. So from verse 1 again, he says, the fifth angel sounded, and I saw a star falling from heaven to the earth. What does that mean? I saw a star falling from heaven to the earth. Stars in the Bible represent what? Represent angels. Yeah? Stars represent angels. So you have physical stars. So everything in the Bible starts physical, and then there's symbols. So stars in the Bible represent angels. Stars in the Bible represent ministers of the gospel, pastors, and all that. So here in verse 1, he says, I saw a star falling from heaven. He didn't say, I saw a star falling, as in coming down from heaven. No. I saw a star falling from heaven. I saw a star who had fallen. A star who had previously fallen from heaven. Now, Bible readers, and especially for those of you who attend Thursday Bible study, last week in Luke chapter 10, verse 18. Luke chapter 10, verse 18. Let's go there. Luke 10, 18. What did Jesus say when the 70 disciples returned back to him, and they will tell him how successful they were? What was Jesus' first word in Luke chapter 10, verse 18? He says, and he said to them, I saw Satan fall like lightning from heaven. Remember, I saw Satan fall like lightning from heaven. And if you go to Revelation chapter 12, verse 9, where did that happen? Revelation 12, verse 9. Let's look at how it happened. Revelation chapter 12 and verse 9. He says, so the great dragon was cast out, that serpent of old, called the devil and Satan, who deceives the whole world. He was cast to the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. So when John the Revelator said, I saw a star falling from heaven, that is, I saw a star who had fallen from heaven, he was actually talking about who? He was talking about Satan. He was talking about the devil, because he had fallen. But remember, not only Satan fell, the Bible says his angels were cast into the earth with him. So when his angels landed on the earth, two things happened. Some ran around the earth, while the majority of them were locked up in the abyss awaiting the day of judgment. The majority of demons were locked up, and which are, that's the second Peter, they were locked up, chapter 2, I believe, they were locked up awaiting the day of judgment. But then we now see something happen here. He says, to him, so you can see, he was talking about the devil there, was given the key to the bottomless pit. The bottomless pit is the abyss. It is the prison where demons are kept. Verse 2. And he opened the bottomless pit. And what happened when he opened the bottomless pit? And smoke arose out of the pit, like the smoke of a great furnace. Now, what was happening here? Satan was given permission to go hurt the earth. I will see the reason why in a minute. Given permission to go hurt the earth, and what did he do? He opened up the abyss. Now, if you remember the story of the Gadarenes, the two demons who were the mob, remember the mob? Who were inside these two men. When they came to Jesus, they said, "Lord, please do not cast us into the abyss. Don't cast us into the prison. Please do not cast us into the abyss." And Jesus said, "Okay." And Jesus allowed them to go into the swine. And from the swine, they went into the sea. But here, the devil was given the key to open up the bottomless pit, and what came out was locusts. Now, the locust here represents demons, because it is demons that you have in the bottomless pit. Amen. So they came out and looked at what they did. These guys meant business. He says, "Some the sun and the air were darkened because of the smoke of the pit." Verse 3, "Then out of the smoke, locusts came upon the air, and to them was given power, as scorpions of the air have power." So, what do we see here? The devil opens up the bottomless pit, the demons came out, and they were given power, meaning whatever they had come to do, they had power to do it. Meaning, whatever purpose they had been least was going to be successful for a period, for a time. That was they've been given power upon the earth, like scorpions have power. And what are they meant to do? He says, verse 4, they were commanded. I said, I wish we knew that time. They were commanded. Who commanded them? God, who is as always in charge of all kinds of locusts. Be it physical locusts, human locusts, or demonic locusts. And God reigns over all forms of locusts. Amen. And it doesn't matter how much they try to come against us, they will not succeed because they are under the command of God Himself. Look at verse 4. He says, they were commanded not to harm the grass of the earth, nor any green thing or any tree, but only those men who do not have the seal of God on their foreheads. Amen. They were commanded not to harm the grass of the earth, nor any green thing or any tree, but those men who do not have the seal of God on their foreheads. It means that these locusts were only allowed to attack people who did not have the seal of God upon their heads. Amen. Those of us who have the seal of God upon our heads are kept from these locusts. Amen. That is the good news of today's message, that God commanded these locusts, go unleash terror upon the earth, but do not touch my saints. So when he says there, the grass of the earth, green tree, or any tree, passes by all the trees of righteousness. Amen. In Zechariah chapter 1, so we're called the trees of righteousness in Isaiah chapter 61, verse 3. In Zechariah chapter 10, verse 1, this is ask the Lord for rain in the time of the latter rain. And the Lord will bring many bright clouds and give rain to every grass in the field. Talking about revival, we are the grass in the field of the Lord. Amen. So when he says to this locust, do not have the green thing or the grass or the tree, he was actually talking about believers. He's talking about us as Christians. The only people they are allowed to hurt are people who do not have the seal of God upon their foreheads. And those people fall into two different categories. Amen. The first category are people on the earth who do not believe. So, people who have refused to accept Jesus as their personal Lord and Savior have this terror released upon the earth as judgment against them. That is why. The other set of people are believers who are living a life of compromise. Those ones too do not have the seal of God upon their voice. I don't care if you are called Christian. or your name is believer, or you are known to the Pope or to the pastor, if you don't have a personal relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ and live a life of holiness, then you do not carry the seal upon your forehead. And if you do not carry the seal upon your forehead, we know what is happening. He said, this locust were asked to torment those who do not have the seal of God upon their foreheads. Now look at verse 5. He says, and they were not given authority to kill them, but to torment them for 5 months. Their torment was like the torment of a scorpion when it strikes a man. In those days, men will seek death and will not find it. They will desire to die, and death will flee from them. What does this mean? We are living in an age and a time where deception and depravity has been unleashed by hell upon the church and upon the earth. Deception and depravity. It means men will begin to do things that are not normal and it will be generally accepted as the norm. We're living in an age of a new normal. There's a new way of doing things. And all those who have given their lives to Jesus will just fall for it. And because these locusts have power, these locusts will break through men. These locusts will go into governments. And any government who tries to stand against them, they will talk down on them. Because they have been given the power to do so. They are so powerful, they will change laws, they will change times, they will change cities. Depravity amongst men. But not only that, you also have deception in the church. Because the angels of the enemy, those who are just out there, they also work in the church. And their goal is to slowly but surely kill the love of God in the hearts of men. Slowly but surely cut off the relationship between man and God. And they are everywhere. So as it is happening outside of the church to stop new people from coming into the church, so we see it happening inside the church to take people back into the world. That is the day and age we're living in. And the angel is sounding the trumpet that this is an important matter. Hold on to your faith. Amen. Hold on to your faith. Do not have, in Revelation 21, about the seven churches, he says, keep that which you have. Hold on to your faith. Let what you have is taken away from you. Deception is rife in the church. False apostles, false prophets, false teachers, false pastors are everywhere. And because they work for the devil, they will have power for a season. They will be able to deceive men. They will use lies, signs, and wonders against men. And the Lord is telling us this morning that unless we have the seal upon our foreheads, we will fall prey towards their doing. I pray that the works of the enemy will not be successful in our lives in the lives of the Lord Jesus. That the Lord will keep us from their antics and from all that they are doing in the name of Jesus. Now, notice the Bible, he says, they are not giving power to kill. They will not kill people. So, this is not, you know, when I was reading comments on this and I was talking this, people had said, oh, it was false religion, and then you mentioned there was a religion that came at this time. Oh, it was the Gophites, it was the Babylonians, it was all these kinds of people, and all of that. Whilst those dimensions may be true, there is a deeper spiritual dimension to it. Amen. And these people, they will not kill people, but their actions will lead to depravity. And you know what's really, really bad about it? Everyone will be saying, yes, it's the way to go, but the people will be suffering because these demons will be tormenting them. The fact that they're causing depravity in the world and deception in the church does not mean that those people who are doing it are enjoying what they're doing. On the outside, they'll tell you it's fine, it's a free world, we do what we want, but they are dying on the inside, they are tormented on the inside, they are suffering on the inside. Because when you move away from God, you don't have anything to cover you from suffering. Amen. So he says the action, that's fine. The action is not to kill people, but to cause them to be tormented. And the emptiness and lack of peace will make people sit there. People like, you know what, you know, let's just end. There's no, when you start hearing people say, there's no meaning to life. There's no meaning to life, let's just end it. He says, what? Even death will flee away from them. Death will not come near them. Death will not come near them. Now, from verse 7, it gives to describe what these locusts look like. And let's look at that so we can take some lessons from it. Verse 7, it says, the shape of the locusts was like horses prepared for battle. They will be strong. These locusts will be strong. When they enter into men, those men will be strong. The Bible says, when these demons fell from heaven, and they came into conjugal relationship with men. He said giants were formed on earth. Men of renown. Giants all over there in that time. That is exactly what is still happening in our days. They might not be giants physically, but these men will be strong. These men will hold governments to ransom. These men will push the agenda, the Satan's agenda. These men will push it on the earth. He says the shape of the locusts was like horses. For battle, very strong and very organized too. Very organized. He says, on their heads were crowns of something like gold. What does that mean? Because they will conquer so many lands, they will get their ideas into so many nations. They will be like kings, they will be kingmakers. In fact, if you don't go to them and agree to their plans, you will not be crowned as a king. They will be the kingmakers. That's why it says, on their heads, they will have crowns of something like gold. Now look at this next one. And their faces were like the faces of men. So you can see that on the outside, when you look at them, you are looking at human beings. But the truth of the matter is, their demons unleashed from hell. But here's what you can see. Verse 8. And they had hair like women's hair. I'll leave you to interpret that. Their face is like the face of a man. So maybe they have hair, they have mustache, they have everything. But the hair is like the hair. It's like the women's hair. And their teeth were like lion's teeth. Very strong. If they attack you, they will attack well. You know? And they have breastplates, and the breastplates of iron. They are protected. They are shielded. The Lord supports them. And the sound of their wings was like sound of chariots with many horses running into battle. Even though they are small, they are little, yet they are very, very powerful. You hear of them wherever you go. You hear their voice, you hear what they say. You hear their actions wherever they are. And then verse 10, it says, they had tails like scorpions, and there were stings in their tails. What does this mean? It means what you see on the outside, what you see on the outside looks like a normal human being who's promoting peace and all of that. Remember, deception is something that looks like it, but it's not it. So, from the outside, in the first prophets in the church, from the outside, it looks like they mean well, but you don't know that the sting is in their tail. In the world also, they are promoting peace, they are telling everybody, we are trying to make things work, we are creating something that works for everybody, and yet, the sting is where is in their tail. The sting is in their tail. So, he said that tails are scorpions, and there were stings in their tails. Their power was to cause men 5 months. What does that mean? It means God is in charge of all of this that is happening. And he will give them a short span of time to carry out their work on the earth, and then he will restore. Amen. So when God says, I will restore unto you the years that the locusts have eaten, one of the things he's saying is, for all the years that these demons have walked upon the earth to make say he will restore. He will come back and bring revival upon the earth and change what is happening on the earth. They will not be around forever. Amen. He says, the power of the God's men for 5 months. And the other sheep over there, the angel of the bottomless pit, whose name he will survive. But in Greek, he has the name Apollyon. John chapter 10, verse 10, he says, the thief does not come, but to kill, to steal, and to destroy. He says, for I am come that they may have life and they may have it more abundantly. The thief has come to steal, to kill, and to destroy. But Jesus has come to give us life. Amen. He says, his name in Hebrew is Abaddon. But in Greek, he has a name, Apollyon, meaning destroyer. The enemy is out to destroy. But note from this passage that what God has not given him power to kill people. He says, he has not given power to kill. And number two, they've been given a short time span to carry out the work on the earth, and the Lord says he will take them away. And when he does that, then restoration will come unto us. Amen. I'll show you two more things and then we'll round up for this morning. Number one, pray is very quickly. Number one, remember their stars. He said because their stars. Their stars was a star who fell from heaven. Now, because their stars, they are shining. There is something in them which shines. There is something about them which attracts. There is something in them which you see them and it looks good on the outside. It looks like this is what I need. This is what I want. But the truth of the matter is, it's just a facade of the outside. I'll show you, let me show you the scripture. 2 Corinthians. 2 Corinthians chapter 11. 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 13 to 15. 2 Corinthians 11, verse 13 to 15. He says, For such are false apostles. False apostles. Deceitful workers. Now, they are apostles, but they are false. False apostles. Apostles are meant to be genuine. Apostles are meant to be people who are close to God. Apostles are meant to be people who are one with God up to a level. But it says they are false. False apostles. Deceitful workers. Workers in God's vineyard. But they are deceitful. He says, transforming themselves into apostles of Christ. And no wonder, for Satan himself transforms himself into an angel of light. Therefore, it is no great thing if his ministers also transform themselves into ministers of righteousness, whose head will be according to their works. So, like I said, they will be found in churches. They will be found around us. You will see them and they have a facade of righteousness. Of course, they look good. They know what they're doing. But the truth of the matter is, they represent the enemy. That's the fashion in the church. The fashion in the world, they will be in government, they will be in power, they will be orators, great speakers, telling us, oh, this is a new world order. This is what we need to do to move things forward. But remember, the esteem, like a copy of, is in their tail. They hunt men with their tails. They hide that behind them. You don't see that when they're talking, but their actions is to cause torment to men everywhere. So that's the first thing I want to show us. Two more things and we'll land up for this one. So you then wonder, why then would God allow them? Why would God allow them on the earth? I'll show you the scripture, Romans chapter 1, verse 18 to 21. Romans 1, verse 18 to 21. So, first thing, we see that they are deceivers, both within the church and outside of the church. Number two, God released them for a reason. Romans 1, 18 to 21. For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men, who suppress the truth in unrighteousness. These people have been fighting against God for a long time. Because only the Lord of God is manifested in them, for God has shown it to them. For since the creation of the world, his invisible attributes are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that to die for them. He's preaching the gospel to them. Men have told them about Jesus. But verse 21. Because although they knew God, they did not glorify him as God, nor were thankful, and became full mind in their thoughts, and their foolish hearts were darkened. So God released them to judgment because they had become rebellious and they had rejected every offer. I read something somewhere this week. He says, mercy is not forever. There's a period God will have mercy, and after that, there will be judgment. God is merciful. His mercies endure. He endures as long as possible, but there comes a time when man will pay for their wickedness. So that's why God releases these demons upon the earth to carry out judgment upon men who refuse to accept him as their Lord and Savior. But the good news this morning is that for those of us who have the seal of God upon our heads, we are kept safe from all these calamities. Amen. He says in Luke chapter 10, verse 19. Luke chapter 10, verse 19. This is where Jesus promised us this. Luke chapter 10, verse 19. Luke chapter 10, verse 19. He says, behold, see, I give you the authority to trample on serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall by any means hurt you. Amen. We live in a time when COVID is everywhere, disaster everywhere, deception in the church, debate in the world, but the Bible says we've been given authority to trample on all of them, and nothing shall by any means hurt us. The Lord has given us victory even before all of us began. Amen. Bible says in him we are more than conquerors through him who has loved us. He has given us victory. So, what do we need to do then? When we look around us and we see a world heading out to destruction, when we look around us and we see depravity amongst men, when we look around us and we see the love of people waxing cold in the church, when we look around us and we see things that parents are giving to their children, children to their parents, brothers to brothers, sister to sister, mother-in-law to daughter-in-law, father-in-law to son-in-law, what do we do? The solution is in 2 Chronicles. Last scripture this morning. 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verse 13 to 15. I'll pack it up there. 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verse 13 to 15. 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verse 13 to 15. It says, when I shut up heaven and there is no rain, now note this next bit, or command the locusts to devour the land, either physical locusts as we saw in Egypt, or an invading army as we saw in the Midianites, or demons from the bottomless pits. He says, or send pestilence among my people. How do we change it? How do we come out of it? Verse 14, our favorite scripture, one of our favorite scriptures. If my people, who are called by my name, will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and I will forgive their sin and heal their land. He says, now my eyes will be opened and my ears attentive to the prayers made in this place. Amen. God has not given up on the world. Amen. And he has not given up on us also. Amen. And he has made a way for us to come back to him. If my people are called by my name, will humble themselves. He says, if we will humble ourselves, he's not asking the world to do it. He's asking us to do it. Humble before it affects the world. Remember Gideon last week. What was supposed to have to do? Fight the Midianites? No. Build an altar unto the Lord. That was the first thing he had to do. Build an altar. Get instructions, and then the Lord gave him victory. This morning, I want us to check our hearts. Let's bow our heads and pray as we land on this morning. I want us to check our hearts and say, Lord, if there's any area in me where my life is not pleasing you, Lord, have mercy on me. Restore me in the mighty name of Jesus. There are locusts around affecting people. Locusts, pestilence, all kinds of challenges, all kinds of problems. We see that locusts come to each of the harvest. They don't come when you sow the seed, because the seed cannot be seen. But it is when there's harvest, that's when they come. And I don't know if there's a locust attacking your harvest, a locust attacking your life. This morning, I want us to say, Lord, have mercy on us. Forgive us in the name of Jesus. We stand in the gap on behalf of ourselves, our brothers, our sisters, our family members, people out there. And we say, Lord, have mercy on us in the name of Jesus. We acknowledge our sins. We acknowledge that we are not being righteous, we are not being holy. And we ask for forgiveness. We ask for grace this morning. We follow your word. We say, Lord, we are sorry for all the things that we have done, which are not pleasing unto you. And I want us also to pray that, Father, turn to us. Lord, turn to us. Turn to me. Turn to my family. Turn to us, O Lord. And bring about change in the name of Jesus. And we pray that for ourselves also. Say, Lord, turn to me. Turn to me. Turn to my household. Turn to me, O Lord. Bring about change. Bring about a turnaround in my life in the name of Jesus. Lord, I pray for myself. And I pray for your people who are listening and those who will watch this message in the future. Father, I pray, Lord, forgive us, have mercy on us, Lord, and talk to us in the name of Jesus. Forgive us and heal the land, Lord. May your eyes and your ears be attentive. May your eyes be open unto us. May your ears be attentive to our prayers that we have made in this place this morning. In the mighty name of Jesus. We thank you, Lord, we worship you. And if there's anyone who has not given their life to Christ, this is a good day to do so. And Lord, I commit them into your hands, as many as those who love you are listening. Father, come into their hearts. Change them. Transform them. May your seal be upon their foreheads, so that they will escape the invasion of the locusts of demons coming upon the earth in the name of Jesus. We thank you, Lord, we worship you. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. Amen.